This is going to be a pretty exciting seminar. I can't think of a better place to have the heads of design from the big three auto manufacturers in one place than here in Motor City in Detroit. So you have here Jonathan Stein, who's going to be moderating the panel. Jonathan was previously with Automobile Quarterly and is now the editor-in-chief of the Hagerty magazine. Right down the line here, we have Michael Simcoe, who is the brand new global design chief for GM, Moray Callum, vice president of design for Ford Motor Company, and Ralph Giles, who's the head of design for Fiat Chrysler. We've got a screen that's going to come up in a second, but we'll go ahead and get started. Here you go, Jonathan.
No, I don't think we have a screen. I don't need the mic. I need my notes.
Better?
Can't trust the help these days. I'm so sorry. Thank you, Brad. You know, I can't tell you how delighted I am to have these gentlemen here. You know, these are the people who shape the cars we drive. I don't know what we did right to get them here, but thank you so much for being here. You know, we're going to engage these visionaries to get their thoughts regarding the state of automobile design, find out how they do what they do. You know, but I want to know something really basic about them, and I'm sure you will too. Michael, you grew up in Australia. Murray, you're Scottish, and Ralph, you spent a lot of your early years in Canada. Were all three of you drawing cars in school when you should have been paying attention?
I wanted to be an architect, and because I'd been drawing stuff in school, I didn't do the math. So I fell into this business.
Ralph, what about you? Were you drawing cars?
I have a funny story because I was drawing my substitute teacher. And back then, Jordache jeans were very popular, but I hadn't put the pockets in yet. So people thought I was sketching her naked, and they made fun of me, so I switched from people to cars at that point.
Good. Probably a good decision.
That's how it all started.
And Murray?
Well, funnily enough, I sort of drew lots of things when I was a kid, and you probably know I have a brother, and he was also a car designer, and I sort of followed in his footsteps a little bit and started drawing cars, but then went off and drew different things and drew animals and drew buildings and things. And I actually started architecture, and I went to my interview for my architecture course, and I'd done what I thought was a nice, you know, modern building, and I drew a car in front of it. And at the interview, they said, the building's great, but the car is better. So I probably should have listened to them at that point, and I actually still kept on doing the cars. But I followed on doing architecture for a couple of years, but then moved back into car design.
Thank you for that. Now, all three of you have worked internationally, all over the world. And when you were still working on the design board, how much did you draw on international fashion, entertainment trends, toys? What inspires you in the studio? Let's start with Murray.
I think it's probably one of the questions we get asked a lot, and what inspires us. And you'll get a mixture of answers, and sometimes we'll try and be intellectual and give you the name of some obscure Spanish architect or something. But most of the time, everything inspires us. I think everything around us inspires us. And I think, you know, it's, you know, whether it's to do with form or aesthetics, I think, you know, there's objects out there that inspire us from nature, from industrial design, from architecture. I think what's getting more complicated, though, is this whole aspect of HMI, human machine interface, and I think we're needing to be inspired by different objects now, and certainly a lot of product design objects and the machines that people use every day. So that's part of our business that's changed, I think, and what's inspiring us is actually changing, I think.
By nature, I guess we're observers. We look at everything and see everything, and perhaps see too much at times, and that's the inspiration. As Murray says, the business is changing, and so we need to change with it. So the emotional side of the business is still there, and we're passionate about the product, but it's the unseen stuff now that is almost impacting us more as we move into a world of where we're going to approach electric vehicles very, very strongly, and This nasty autonomous vehicle world is coming at us in a hurry. That's a big influence, and so we're going to have to think differently.
Well, I've seen you nodding a lot too, Ralph.
Yeah, I agree with everything they've said. Designers, I think, are naturally observant people. Some wise person said the future is already here; it's just in spits. You know, so you know, I would say the first 10 years of my career, I was pretty oblivious, just kind of a kid with headphones on, sketching away. And then they started to send you on auto shows, and most of the auto shows happened to be in some awesome places all over the world. And I started the habit of walking the town, you know, spending an extra day before the show, and just drinking in the culture, whether it's Europe or Japan or China, wherever. And it's amazing when you observe society and how they live and how cars fit or don't fit in lifestyles. So that's kind of what I was doing back then. Now, obviously, that we have all kinds of research at our fingertips. But it's really about, to what they were saying, is looking outside of your industry a little bit, and especially with the electronics. Movies are a huge source of inspiration, because a lot of our designer friends who didn't go into architecture or car design ended up in sci-fi movies. And talk about limitless imagination. For me, I draw huge inspiration from what the future could be. And if you extract even 10% out of the best sci-fi movies, you actually have a pretty good start, so it's pretty cool.
It's getting a little bit tougher these days, because the customers we're designing things for are now better informed.
They have
access to the things at the speed that we have access to them. So that inspiration is there for them to see. And it doesn't matter whether you're in a traditional third world country or you're here in North America, you can see the same thing at the same time. So it's getting a bit more difficult.
Well, that's how you get your inspiration, but you know, all of you are responsible for teams of hundreds and hundreds of people. How do you motivate them?
Thanks for that.
No pressure.
Did I send you to a deep depression by saying that?
No, just a realization.
Well, you know, when you walk out of here, you never have to see me again. Will that make you feel better?
Yes, to see the hundreds of people.
Yes, there's a little bit of expectation out there.
So how do you motivate the creativity of your people? Do you field trip, group exercises, competition? What do you do to help them get the creativity? You've told me how you get your creativity.
Competition works very, very well. The nice thing about all of us, we have a global network of studios, and we have some incredibly creative people who are inspired anyway. They're in the business, and it's a very emotional place. But we pit them against each other. So the constant competition is what drives a lot of that energy and that creativity.
Is it the same for you, Ralph?
Yeah, and something, yes, we do. And we'd send them on incentive trips to kind of hang out with the customer, especially the extreme brands, some of our sport brands, and Jeep, for example. But what I'm doing lately, something we just started doing this year, is bringing in guest speakers from outside. And we have a lot of connections, again, through the movie industry and other suppliers that have other tracks, like, you know, some of our, like Samsung, Panasonic, they have other businesses, and we asking leaders from their design houses to come and speak to us and open up our eyes. And they're always willing. I mean, there's really no limit there. So it's something we're just starting to do, and I'm going to do more of it, see how it goes. But the kids, honestly, these millennials are, to Mr. Simcoe's point, are so clued in. I mean, it's just a keystroke away. Their rate of absorption is fascinating.
Yeah. No, I think so, and I think competition's great, and I think you need to get like right balance between competition and working together as a team, and that's probably sort of one of our hardest roles, I think, to encourage competition but then encourage teamwork at the same time. And I think it's really good sometimes to reach out of your sort of normal sort of scope of things. A couple of years ago, we had a design competition to design objects for the Milan Furniture Fair, which was a really good, it was a global competition. We asked all our designers around the world to just design anything they wanted, as long as it wasn't a car. And it was really exciting, because we thought everything would come in with wheels in it, but nothing did. And it was actually some really good results from that, great motivation for designers. We made a lot of these objects and we showed them at the Milan Furniture Fair. So it shows that our designers are also, I think people think the car designers are just pretty single-minded and they'll think cars, but I think designers are designers, and you give them any different object to design, they can actually be quite talented at it.
Did any of that translate to being used in automobiles?
It didn't quite translate, but we actually asked them to use our interior design language to influence the object. So it worked. It helped them understand the design language and demonstrate different ways of using it. So it was actually very useful.
Now, in the past, you've used everything in culture, we've seen ships, aircraft, spacecraft, computers. As we enter the world of the autonomous car, and what do you see entering design language as we move forward? Are there any new places you're going to be gathering information from?
I think there'll be different influences in different new places. I mean, obviously, you know, we can't have a talk these days without mentioning autonomous cars, and obviously the Google car is probably not going to influence many people, but it's telling you something that car design might change. And I think we all have heard that Apple is producing a car, and they can probably get away with doing a product design language in a car that none of us would be able to get away with at the moment. And when they do that, then I think it might change that whole realm of car design and what people think about cars and how people react to them. It'll be less emotional, it'll be very Apple design, it'll be very logical. And I think currently, we probably wouldn't want to do that, but I think they will do that and it'll change people's perception of what a vehicle is.
Yeah, the core technology, the thing that drives the autonomous, the electrification, is going to allow us to do quite different things with proportion and the way we package a vehicle and the way we entertain and place people in the vehicle.
But it's interesting, if you look at Tesla, for example, they chose to do a car, or just a good-looking car. You know, they didn't choose to do a science project or do something quite wacky. And they could have done something much more different, but they actually just took all the basic rules we know how to make a car look good and put it onto the car. Yeah,
so I'm sure there'll be boxes as well as good-looking things going forward.
So the traditional automakers, Ralph, are more likely to go evolutionary first?
That's a good question. I think Michael said it best. The proportions are definitely going to change as the IC engine goes away, freeing up. And I think the interior is going to take much more precedence over the vehicle. I think what's more interesting to me is the idea of sharing cars. Like when the cars are more and more shared, a portion of the future market will have shared cars. And then it's not owned by anyone. So there's not that natural affection for the car. So it has to be built to be more robust because a lot of people are going to be in and out of it, easier to clean, things like that. But at the end of the day, I remember being a kid sitting in a Montreal subway and just being upset how generic it was, right? So why should I suffer? You know, everything you see should be beautiful. I don't think we should add more visual pollution to the normal pollution, right? So, yeah. And I think some of these products will come from automakers that want the branding effect, you know? So when it goes down the road and it has the brand gloriously displayed, I think it matters. So whether it's a product-oriented design, it still should be attractive. So we'll see. I mean, it's really a moving target.
To that point, I mean, I get asked by journalists regularly now because they've seen this autonomous word and everyone wants to know the future. And the question is always, will autonomous just wipe out any emotion or wipe out our business? Yeah. And I think, no. I mean, people are still going to want to have some sort of connection to the vehicle, and there'll still be, hopefully in our lifetimes, people who appreciate the work we do.
Yeah.
That we put soul into the vehicles, or our teams put soul into the vehicle.
It's a business of emotion.
One thing I'd like to add to that is one early indicator of that there's a lot of change is if you look at where we used to hire designers, I've been hiring for the last 10 years now, we used to always go to the same design schools and hire the typical hot sketcher dude. Now we're hiring from the toy industry, the animation industry, product design industry, electronics industry, robotics engineering. We're really grabbing kids and we're actually transferring some people out of parts of our company into design. Yeah. And it's really creating an interesting, a very fertile garden of ideas, right? So and I think that's reflective of our times.
Now, are the people you're pulling, are they people who are mostly designing by computer, or are you still pulling freehand artists? What is it? Is it all computer?
Some as the kids really jump right into the tablets, the electronic tablets. Mm-hmm. It's more efficient. But a lot of them, when you really sneak around and watch them, they still pull from the Xerox machine, steal some sheets of paper, and noodle, because the equipment's is kind of cumbersome at the end of the day. But they're very, very comfortable in the electronic medium. And the electronic medium's gotten so good that there's no limitation. The old days, everything was stiff looking. Now, the pressures are so good on the latest stuff.
I think it's still a good test for certainly an exterior designer that if they can sketch a vehicle, then they tell you they understand form as well. So I think it's if they can translate 3D into 2D, they can usually translate 2D back into 3D. So I think we're all probably still traditionalists in this, but how they develop that sketch is up to them. They can use electronic means, they can use digital means. But I think there is, as Ralph says, I think there's an expansion of our role from just being form designers to being the interior designers, to being to being the experienced designers as well in terms of what the experience people are actually going to have in their vehicle. And our role is really to develop that as well.
Yeah. And ultimately, it all has to become three-dimensional. So it's a bit more visceral than simply the sketching in the computer. I'm sure there's, because of the generations that have come through with gaming in their lives from day one, there'll be a time where there's a better understanding of what's in the machine, if you like, rather than on the sketchpad.
But a funny thing about adopting technology early, we were very early adopters to the digital tools of design. And the cars started looking really bizarre, very squared, unfinished. And we almost thought, hey, one day clay modeling will disappear. Right now we're finding that we're using clay modeling as much as ever, but differently.
I think we've probably all been through that phase. I think we all thought digital was the way to go 10, 15 years ago. And I think you could spot the cars that were done purely digitally, and now I think we've tried to meet that sort of happy medium between digital and physical modeling as well. Digital's great tool to get things quickly and to engineer things, but there's still a finesse you can do on hand modeling that's still not quite there in digital modeling. Yeah, certainly for people like us, I think, who have grown up with clay models, I think younger designers will be getting more and more comfortable with digital modeling and creating beautiful forms with them without having to come in and give it that finesse with basic modeling.
Yeah, I think the computers, computer and the surfaces we generate that way are ultimately our product.
Yeah.
But on the way, what's happened is we found better ways to come from a hand modeled surface, record it photographically, and turn it around faster. So computers have helped in that way, but there's still this form in the room which you react to.
Speaking of the form, do the three of you have had to, as you've moved up the ladder, you've had to become managers. Do you get to really design anymore? Do you get to create? Ralph, you sighed the heaviest.
Can I have a bourbon? Does anybody got a bourbon in here somewhere? Well, we get caught in, I'm sure all of you have the same experience, we get caught in a lot of meetings, right? A lot of decisional meetings.
No.
And we expose ourselves to business cases and all that stuff. So I would say no, not as much. A lot of people ask me, hey, they give you credit for, hey, Ralph, Jill's pen this and pen that. I haven't penned anything in the last 5 years. I doodle a lot, always when the meetings get kind of boring, when no one's looking, I'm still sketching just for therapeutic reasons. But we're more like movie directors now. And movie producers, and we let the actors and the talent.
Well, that's a good one. We'll use that.
But you get
unfortunately, people do take notice of what we say occasionally.
But you get to guide what's happening in shape.
Yeah. Still put that tape line on. Yeah.
I'll sneak into my office and do a few pen sketches, or even some Photoshop stuff, before I actually ask some of the guys to do something, because I've checked it out myself to see if it was going to work or not. So I usually do a lot of sketching for myself, but I don't usually show them to many people anymore. But it's still therapeutic to all of us, I think.
Yeah.
And are you pretty much in the same boat?
Yeah, I think I said it before. We spent a lot of time directing and I guess trying to stay involved as much as we can. But sometimes certainly I'm not close enough to what's happening in detail. And occasionally you'll make a comment and it'll become real, and that can be unfortunate.
And our job is more to really sort of protect the design and the designers really a lot of the time to actually protect the original thought and keep that going and keep it alive and keep it sane, keep it what we wanted it to be.
And Mike said a good thing is the power of the word. It's amazing when you sit and you make an off comment, and then a week later you see a whole design change based on something you were just joking about.
But that's what you said.
That's what you said. It's in print.
Who did that ugly car thing? Because you did. You told us to do it. So you got to be careful.
Yeah. What influence you have.
One question that I had, and let's talk a little bit about heritage and car design. Michael, is new more important than brand?
I don't think you could put them in competition with each other. Brand is the customer, and it's essentially what we do. and knew we have to do, otherwise we're not going to be able to sell those brands to people. So
you balance.
They're not in competition.
Yeah.
You've got to balance. You've got to have both.
Well, yeah, that's the business.
Well, I think you can have both fully as well. It's not half brand, half new. You can have all new and all brand, yeah. I think. So it's not really, I agree, it's not really in competition.
Yeah, we had that moment of reckoning when we did the Cherokee, right? The slit, slanty-eyed Cherokee we did. And we look at the Grand Cherokee, we look at the Wrangler, and we have these two tracks of Jeep DNA, and we brought in this incremental car, and we got beat up. I mean, talk about hate. And then now the car
is selling well, is it?
300,000 last year is a best-selling Jeep, you know. So, So as long as I think if you have, and it has some brand truths. There's a few things that anchor back to the brand, which are very critical. But for the most part, you have to take some risks.
And I think there are tough ones out there when you've got the brand is so strong, like Mustang or Jeep or something like that, or Corvette. You know that you need to measure that element of newness. You know, but I think people still want it to be new and the newest version. I think so.
Yeah, but don't trade them off against each other.
No,
I mean music still has five notes. You know, the tempos forever. So.
You know. These days, you know, you mentioned how immediate media is, and information travels so quickly. Is it common for automotive design influence to cross company boundaries? You know, once upon a time, the brand new 57 Chryslers influenced what came out in the 59 GM cars, or the Shelby Daytona Coupe impacted the Viper GTS. How often do you get influenced?
Yeah, the trite answer and the correct answer is no, we never influence each other.
The real answer is...
However, the real answer goes back to the inspiration. I mean, that you can't help be in the world without a GM designer seeing Chrysler, Fiat, Ford. It just happens. And by osmosis or by something that happens in here, there's an influence. You can't
As Ralph said, I mean... We all go to the same schools to pick up designers as well, so they're actually sort of coming through the same system together. They're learning the same trends.
Sometimes these punks poach my people. So.
Yeah, and and vice versa.
Only the good ones.
Now I want to put you on the spot, Ralph. Is there something that they've done at GM in the last 5 years that you really really like? Can you admit to it?
I love the Cadillac movement, and I think the El Mirage was one of the most beautiful cars I've ever seen, you know, in terms of a grand American car, and I'm waiting for that day to come back. You know, these, and in the Cadillac brands like Cadillac have, I mean, there's songs written about Cadillacs, and it has the right to do that. So, things like that, the new Ford GT, oh my God, I mean, it's a show car. It's a show car that you can buy. I mean, so there's moments
only if you got your name picked. That's
okay. Yeah. My friends were all showing me the letters, the rejection letters, you're on the list letters, and you're a badass, you're getting one letter. So things like that, where you know that. What I respect the most about design is when I know there was a struggle, because you can tell as a designer, you know that car went through a hell of a process to make it all the way through. Yeah. And you have to respect the gumption of the company, the gumption of the designers, the battles, all of that is now, boom, it's permanent, it's part of our popular culture, no one can take it away, and history was made. So that is hard to ignore.
And the more iconic the nameplate, the harder the battles are.
Exactly.
Because it's that important.
But even sometimes the more banal the car is, the harder the battle is. I mean, in terms of the family sedan, for example, it's really tough to get really, really strong design into these. And as I say, protecting that design as it's going through. Because it's probably one of the toughest vehicles to do, you know, sort of small sort of C-class car to make it successful and make it profitable. Mm. So it's actually a big challenge to actually go through that process. And sports cars tend to be more emotional, but in a way they're easier, you know. You had a much nicer package.
But there's more people who'll tell you that they're wrong.
Yes, yeah, that's
more
true.
More critics.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
I just realized something. I don't have an accent.
Yes, you do.
we're all foreigners.
I put on an accent, so it'll be interesting.
Well, you can use anyone you want.
You can do a good Jamaican. How's that?
How about French Canadian? Can you do that?
Now,
this is a question for all three of you. And this might tell us a little bit about where you came from. A designer friend who trained at Art Center came up with this one. What was your favorite car toy as a kid? And was it instrumental in your later career choice? And is there something about that toy that still inspires you as your work? And it looks like you found one, you thought of one, Ralph.
And I still have this little yellow Hot Wheels my dad bought for me. I was gonna bring it today and I totally forgot. But there was another thing I bought myself, and it was a 928 telephone. Back then, it was all the rage to have these car telephones, I don't know if you remember those.
Must have been from the wheels.
I remember painting it and trying to make it look even more real. But the 928 is one of those vehicles that was way, way ahead of its time. You know, and as a young person, when I grew up in the 70s, and cars were pretty, pretty hideous for the most part.
Like, have a look at a 928 and an AMC Pacer. Seriously, it's like a squish. Have a look at the Tucson design. Very similar, and apparently, one of the guys that worked on the 928 was inspired by the Pacer, which you might not believe. But if you look at them, they're actually very similar.
Well, the greenhouse.
Yeah, the greenhouse very similar. Yeah, yeah. Just better proportion.
Do you have any toys that you?
Well, I'm trying to remember actually. And there's this photograph of me. I don't remember. Well, I think I may have them. Photograph of me my first day at school, and I'm sitting there with my shorts on, my cap, my school uniform. And it's outside, and there's two dinky toys on the window shelf. Mm-hmm. One is an E-type coupe, and the other one is a 1959 El Camino. Yeah. So maybe show us the sort of bizarre sort of choice of cars I sort of like in my life. But that was there's a truck in there somewhere. So but I think there's a nice Jag as well.
And do you still have them?
I think I do. Yes. Yeah. Somewhere, but with no tires on them. For some reason, when I was a child, I chewed all the tires off my car. So if anyone has a collection of spare tires for model cars, I'd really appreciate it. I won't eat them.
He has a little Hannibal in him.
I go all the way back to Corgi toys. Corgi, remember Corgi toys? Yeah.
What is that?
Corgi.
Corgi, as in Corgi dog.
They were a little bigger.
Corgi and Dinky, they were same size.
Well, being Australian, all of this stuff that got dumped out of the UK found its way to
including
down
the people.
South.
I have to look that up after.
And it was it's the only one I remember, which is a bit strange, a Bluebird, Donald Campbell's Bluebird.
Oh, yeah. Beautiful. The record breaker.
Yeah, yeah, and I know I had it long enough to have no paint on the outside of it and no wheels, but I've got no idea where it is now. It's gone. But it was a beautiful form, but it was only this big. I guess it was scaled to me in those days.
Did you ever draw it?
They're so pure forms. Yes, you do. I mean, did I consciously draw that? No, but the forms are so pure in itself. Yeah, somewhere in my life I probably have. Before I stopped drawing and managed.
As you and your team are coming up with the designs, do you find that the constraints, the safety constraints, like bumper heights, headlamp heights, the heights that you have to have should pedestrians be hit, all the safety constraints, do they really make it hard to distinguish one car from another? Does it really hurt the creative process?
I think we all wrestle with that, but our job is to deal with criteria and not lose the emotion of the design. So, if you give into it, then nothing gets through. You don't create. So they're constraints, but they're constraints that we're used to dealing with, and you work around them, and you can still create a beautiful vehicle.
And I think good design is all about working through constraints and problems. You know, it's if there was no constraints and no problems to solve, you know, then I think, you know, it would be awesome. But it certainly wouldn't be as challenging, and I don't think it would be as, you know, it makes it more of a challenge to work through these constraints, and I think that actually makes the job more interesting. I think.
But that's what makes designers rather than stylists.
Yeah,
industrial.
But there was a time when it seemed, maybe in the 90s, when all the mid-size sedans, the Camrys and the Malibus, you paint them white, put them in a rental fleet, and they absolutely all looked like the same jelly bean.
Before Mike was in his job.
But I don't think you can blame the constraints for that.
Yeah.
No. That's us not doing our job.
Yeah, and sometimes what happens is constraints come so quickly that the platform is already set and you're working around an existing platform. And when you have a chance to do a new platform, you move like the pedestrian impact. You can move components when you redesign a platform deeper into the vehicle so you don't have to bulbous the hood, right? So we look at those constraints in design forms. So the cars tend to go through a bit of an adolescent, awkward stage, and then quickly you see technology triumphs rescue the design. So headlamp technology now is getting smaller. We can package. We have more crush space, cooling, all this stuff. So, So it's just about the answer to that is keeping your engineer friends as close to you as possible.
It's sort of the way you keep your friends close and your enemies closer.
Even closer than that.
Yes.
but we can't call engineers enemies.
So you keep them close, but not too close.
No, it's a partnership. If it's not a partnership, you can't get anything done.
I don't think we would lie. When we go to these shows like tomorrow and you see the older cars, I have tears to my eyes.
You're jealous of
them. Yeah, when I see the pillars that are like pencils.
And
the chrome that are Dagmars, I mean, it's...
Well, would you like to go back to the days of absolutely no constraints? Would that be wonderful for you?
Just to see what it would be like.
But I think you talk about cars looking similar. They were looking similar then, so it wasn't the constraints that made them similar. So it was actually fashion, it was trends, I think. It's interesting because there was no constraints, but the cars still look very similar in the 30s and 40s.
Skinny tires, wide tires.
And you look back, but it's all very fond memory. I mean, the cars that are out there are the pick of the beautiful ones that exist now because people like them that much. But there were just as many Camrys and other things floating around those days as well.
True, that's a very good point.
Well, you're right. We get to see the pick of the litter, if you will. We don't see.
We get to see the ones that should have been collectible and were collectible. The ones that shouldn't have been collectible never. Yeah. We don't see actually.
The ones that don't do as well in the marketplace now. Is there inspiration to be had in those? In these older cars that you can bring back to the modern cars, even though a lot of modern constraints don't allow.
Yeah, I think there's certainly inspiration in proportions and in not so much in how they're bending sheet metal, but certainly in the proportions of vehicles. Yeah, we would all love to get some of these proportions back, and I think we still strive to get some of these proportions back. You know, just and when I talk about proportion, I'm not just talking about the profile of the car, but the scale of the wheels, the body, and stuff like that. I think there's stuff that can be influenced there that you can. That again, people can agree on what's beautiful, and it's surprising how proportions dictate that, you know. And I think a lot of people, a lot of the cars out there are truly beautiful because of the proportions, and that's something that we talk about all the time.
In the 50s, 60s, 70s, headlights tended to be a real constraint. Do you find that now that you can do so much with headlamps that it's really freed you up?
It's actually created a hell of a lot more work for us. I mean, I envy the days of the headlamp was a 7-inch circle, and that was it.
Popped
just pop it. Now we spend weeks, months designing headlamps, which is great, and the technology is allowing us to do that. But the amount of design work that goes into a headlamp and a tail lamp these days
four corners of the car. Four corners of the car are the most difficult thing to do.
Because
they contain so much. A headlamp, which used to be this big and this thick, is now. Might be this slim, but it's this deep.
Is there one brand that any of you feel has done those four corners better than anybody else?
I think next question.
Yeah.
I think his brother's done a nice job Jaguar. The Jaguar. I like the new F-Type.
I think Audi and BMW are probably forerunners in giving a signature to the lamps. I think certainly BMW with the eyes.
What about Cadillac with those very sharp?
We're not going to compliment any of each other's brands.
Okay, well,
thank you.
I've always had fun, and that was before your time, but you're taking credit for it. Yes. Okay.
No, I think Cadillac is a good example. I think, and again, we're all trying to give our cars a unique signature, not just in daytime but in nighttime as well. Unfortunately, the technology is all quite similar, so the signatures are all getting muddled up as well. I think now, but everyone's following.
And I have an entire studio dedicated just to component design, especially headlamps. Sometimes I have to tell my designers to calm down. Right? They're trying so hard. They're so excited by what they can do. It doesn't mean you should do it, right? Because I think the car's going to go down the road looking very alien. If you're not careful, so we tell, hey, save that for the next design. You know,
the technology is no longer a constraint.
Yeah.
I mean, it's running fast, and in some ways we're catching up to it.
Well, Doesn't it send costs spiraling out of control if every model has a different headlamp and taillight that has to be custom made?
Now you sound like my engineer friends. They would love us to carry over the same lamp in about five cars.
I think it gets back to what's the customer's expectations. And I think we will use commonality where we can be clever with it, but I think people still expect their vehicles to have their own identity. And I think the more common you make the really visible elements, then you're losing that, I think. There are other ways to get commonality that the customer doesn't need to see, I think.
Yeah. A lot of the subcomponents within the lamp are actually common, in some cases to other OEMs as well.
Is there, do the materials that you get to work with dictate how you can, the instructions you have to give your people? So if you're using aluminum, if you're using composites, if you're using steel, do you have to give a different brief to your designers?
Yeah, the characteristics of the material inform the design. There's no getting around that. There's physically certain things you can do with steel that you can do with carbon fiber in a different way, and alloy is different again. So it informs the design. It's just one of those levels of constraint or criteria that we work around. I think designer's job.
Yeah, I think the Ford GT is a good example. We would have only been able to build that car in carbon fiber. We wouldn't have been able to stamp these elements in steel or aluminum. Yeah. So I think that's an advantage. But sometimes aluminum, there's slightly more constraints, for example. But I think we're getting better and we're learning how to use these materials more. And sort of when we used to have very soft radii, they're getting tighter and tighter. So we're just learning more about the material the more we use them.
So how do you get to, for all of you, how do you decide what studio, what team gets to work on a really special project like that? Because that must be a dream to work on a project like that.
Well, I don't know about them, but we actually have branded studios, but with at the head of each studio there's a director, and they work on Jeep and Chrysler, but below them we matrix all the designers, and especially if it's a juicy program, we'll compete it for about 6 weeks or so. And it's the best designer wins. It's that simple. And then they
get to develop.
And I don't care if they've been in the company 6 weeks or 6 years or 10 years, you know. So
yeah, it's the same thing. We have branded studios, and if it's, for instance, the Corvette, there's some core people in that studio who represent the way to do a Corvette, but there's also the young designers who are hugely passionate and have the most creative ideas, and you bring them to bear, and if they, in competition, there's a design you want to chase, then you bring them into the studio and you exploit them.
I think we're more or less saying that the exception for us was probably the Ford GT, which was we wanted to keep that quiet, so we couldn't open it up to everyone. And we handpicked basically a selection of very young, inexperienced designers with like more experienced designers, and actually just married them together. And and they worked very well together. You know, I think it's great to have that freshness from the young designers, but you needed the experience from what you can and can't do from the older designers.
Did any of them get to go along to Le Mans to see what their?
Actually, quite a few of us went to Le Mans. Most of them on their own dime. Actually, went there because they just wanted to be there to see the car, and it was
It must have been exciting.
The fact we won was quite nice as well. So.
Excuse me.
The fact we won was quite nice as well, but it was a great, great, great event for us. And not only that, just the proximity of when we started the program to actually being at Le Mans was really, really cool, because you actually still remembered working on the car as opposed to 10 years later or something like that. So I think it was really, really exciting.
That was sort of history repeating itself too. Yeah. The plan to win and winning was pretty good.
It happened a little more quickly this time.
Yeah, a little bit, yeah.
Just a little. Now, how is the breakdown? You must have many layers of studios and many, these are big operations in many, many countries. Can you give our audience an idea of just how big your operations are? Because it's mind-blowing to me, and I know a little bit about the industry.
I can start. We have 10 studios and about 2,500 people these days. That's not just creative designers. That's the whole gambit of creative designers, mass sculptors, physical sculptors, people who run the operation.
In how many countries?
Five now.
And what about you, Ralph?
We have about 900 designers and engineers and clay modelers spread over four countries, four studios.
Wow.
We have somewhere between the two, actually. I think it's about 1,100 people over seven studios around the world. So, and different scale of studios. So we've got some major studios that do a lot of the production work. We have different smaller studios that are listening posted in London and Shanghai, for example.
How many countries?
Five or six.
So all of you have to hop around the world a little bit to check in on these folks.
Yeah. Yep. Diamond. Are you a diamond?
Yeah.
Delta Diamond.
I'm working on Delta.
You will be.
Qantas is my one.
It's and I think even despite the fact we've got so much electronics these days where we can communicate with each other, we can do WebExes, we can do design reviews real time, I think it's still important to turn up at these studios and meet the people as well. So
that's one thing we're pushing our IT department to help us. We're installing more and more telepresence machines because they're always full, right? Especially with the Fiat.
Live video,
Yes.
Saves a lot.
And it's unfortunately, if you're trying to do it around the world, someone's always up at 3 o'clock in the morning as well, which is, it's usually the Australians, actually.
That's why I came here, dictate the time.
Ralph, are you involved in Fiat design as well?
Absolutely. Now, I did move one of my U.S. designers, who was actually a German. We moved him back to Europe, and he's taken over the Alfa Romeo, Fiat, Maserati brands. And I visit him constantly. But yeah, we're shepherding the next generation of Fiats and Alfa Romeos and Maseratis.
Do you work with some of the outside studios at all?
Yeah, all the time. Yeah. So I'm traveling typically once a month. I go to Brazil about three times a year, go to Italy 10 to 12 times a year. And I go to China maybe twice a year and probably more in the future.
And when do you have time to use those frequent flyer miles?
My wife does. I don't think she's about to take a ticket in a long time.
Yeah. Why don't we, we have plenty of time, why don't we use that for, I've heard some interest, some murmurings, why don't we use some of the time we have for the potential hecklers.
My boss just put his hand up.
Can I honor someone? I have to honor a gentleman that's in the audience real fast.
Please do.
His name is Bill Robinson. He's my junior teacher at CCS.
Can I have a question for you, Ralph?
Can you stand up? I just want to cheer you, because this guy, I think he, how old are you, Bill? I don't want to embarrass you, but.
I'm
going to
be 91 this month.
Oh. 91 years old. Oh, my God. He had the fastest Shelby Daytona.
This question is for you, Ralph. I wanted to congratulate Chrysler Corporation in having the courage to come out with a new expression of the Jeep in the Cherokee. It's something I've been thinking of for a long time, and I know it must have taken a lot of courage to introduce to the Jeep culture a different expression of that. So my question is this. Did it win over the Jeep culture, or did it introduce a whole new customer to the line of Jeeps?
So it did, that's a very good question, and thank you. Yes, it was risky, and we were nervous at the beginning because we had a picture leak out prematurely, and oh my gosh, it was the internet, my Twitter blew up. And what was interesting is social media brings instantaneous feedback, right? So I got literally, it was about 60% hate, 40% like, and as the day went on, we released a nicer picture because it was a picture of a car with the hood up, it was terrible. And all of a sudden, it went 60 like, 40 hate. And as the day went on, I kept retweeting every single comment. And that's exactly what we saw in our clinics. We saw love-hate, which meant it had a lot of tension. And we knew when people would see the car in 3D in real time, they would appreciate the details were there. But the purists were offended by the car because of its origins, its details. So we created the Trailhawk model, which was supposed to be a 10% runner and is now about a 35% runner in terms of sales. That's the one with those stuck-out wheels. And then we showed it doing the Rubicon Trail. Discussion was over. So as long as a Jeep can still do Jeep things, they accept it the way it looks.
So what percentage do you think of the traditional owners?
That data right now, we have about 40-50% conquest. So people that never looked at Jeep before, a lot from Honda and Toyota specifically. And then at the Trailhawk level are people that had older Cherokees, have been waiting, have accepted the new car. So I would say about 50-50.
Yeah, I was wondering about that. Because some of the people, women at our church were buying the Cherokee.
Yeah, that's actually, it's funny because remember the old Liberty with the bug eyes? That was extremely popular with women, and the new one that was square wasn't. So this women came back, and they love. Matter of fact, most of the people that don't buy the Trailhawk are women.
But when you consider the range from the Wrangler to the Cherokee, it's a brand in itself.
Yeah, 3 years ago, I mean, 5 years ago, we had about 4 Jeeps. Now we're closing in on 7, and within a few months, we'll have another model coming, a brand new model. So yeah, we're growing the Jeep brand, and it's resonating across the world. It's the fastest growing brand in the world right now. So.
Well, thank you. I was very curious about how that would be received.
It's your lessons, man. Thank you.
Yes.
He's the best.
What's he going to ask me? God's
sake. So my question is for all three of you. You guys had
created... Can I introduce this gentleman? This is Raj Nair. He's head of product development for the group.
So he's basically... I'm just here as a private
citizen.
He's
basically my boss.
And he's a walking marketing device.
And he's the man mainly responsible for the 4 GTs he see inside, so thanks for that.
That's very kind, but I'm here privately, seriously, so you can say whatever you want.
Cool.
Your boss isn't here.
Wow. Until,
you know there's a problem when he says that.
You have 5 minutes of untouchableness.
But you guys had the creative organizations, but they reside in a broader organization. You know, the rest of the organization that engineers and manufacturers and sells and service your vehicles. Also, you had an organization, but everyone else in the organization has an opinion of the job you're doing and your latest proposal. What are your thoughts, methods, tricks as you work with senior management to get your vision to reality through senior management? And you can't use your accent makes you sound really smart, something other than that.
Other than you, Ralph,
you just sound like a...
Apparently,
I think once upon a time there was a level of arrogance in design. You know, we did our own thing. It was styling was king. I think that's gone away now, and you realize you can actually get more influence through, I guess, a partnership with the people who you see as customers, I suppose. So collaboration works. Actually, talking to people works even better, and that's, you know, that's the change. It's certainly in our organization, it's the change.
Ralph?
Whoa. Well, that's his boss, right? So he's got to... that's a very good question. And in fact, I think a lot of you that aren't in the industry probably imagine I wear a scarf and sketch cars and like rose petals, I just throw the sketches out and the things get made. It doesn't work that way at all. Matter of fact,
the arrogance,
there's what we try to do, and we have something that we feel is unique because we pay attention to the market as well. We have kind of our own internal compass of where we think the company should be. So we're always offering up ideas. And if we think it's really strong, I ask my designers to intoxicate them with the vision, right? Try to bring all the parties involved. There's product planning, engineering, there's a brand team, which is they're the ones who have to sell the car at the end of the day. That's one way to do it. But most of the time, honestly, before we put pen to paper, we actually want to be inundated with data. You know, what is the white space in the segment? What's the competition doing? Where's the opportunity? What's the health of the brand? Do they hate this part of the brand, love this part of the brand? So before you sketch anything, we hyper-educate ourselves. And then when the product planners see us doing that, they respect it. When the engineers see us doing that, they respect that. So before you know it, you have a small, like, Navy SEAL team that's going after this project. So you never really have too much of a struggle once the mission is understood. And at that point, they know they can't sketch, so they pretty much rely on us to try to interpret that in a 3D form. So it's not as painful. I've heard of days when it was really hard, and what I think helped, especially at GM, started this thing where design was aligned to the top of the house. In my case, I report straight to the CEO. In your case, you report to engineering in a way, but obviously it's a great relationship. So as long as there's that mutual respect, the projects fall into place. So your turn now, mister.
Yeah, I mean, I think both guys are right. I think you know, getting a design brief and getting people aligned with that is really important up front, so that when people see the product, they relate it to what you agreed in the design brief. Not always people remember what they agreed to in the design brief as they went through, but I think the other point about working certainly with senior management and working with people you're trying to sell the vehicle to is getting to know their design sensibilities as well and understanding. Some people get it, some people see it, and I always want to put someone else's head on and see what they see, because to us it's blatantly obvious sometimes, and to some people they look and they just don't get it, you know, and I think you need to sort of get to know your audience a little bit and get to know who you're trying to talk to, who you're trying to sell to, and sometimes you can steer the discussion the way that you want them to understand what you're showing them. So it's really getting to know the management.
There's no room for arrogance anymore.
No, there's no room for arrogance at all.
Bang the table.
Yeah, it's not. You know, this is because this is the damn way it's going to be anymore. So you need to. We need to be good salesmen in a way, and we need to. But we need to do it through a process of collaboration so that people understand what it is we're trying to achieve visually with the vehicle. Even with the
now, one thing that's interesting about being in this position is the brand guys try to chum up with you a lot. You know, so they try, hey, you could do this extra sketch, because they want to sometimes, they want that sketch to razzle-dazzle management, right? They're looking for that, because there's a fixed amount of capital in these companies and a lot of dreams. You can't do everything you want to do, so you could imagine the pressure for one brand over the other to get a piece of that capital to see their vision through. So the way Sergio has a company orchestrated, there's a lot of that competition, so I'm a very popular guy.
You become the guy to illustrate their ideas, isn't
it? Yeah, so it's tough to manage that.
Andy?
That was a long answer to this question, but I think.
This is more an industry question. How is the connection, and how do the engineers and the designers work at the end of the day, and how do they share information with each other?
In the studio together.
Yeah.
It's our business is there, and you can see it whether it's a sketch, whether it's on a box, and you're showing an image, or best occasion is having a model there. Bring the people who have to make it real, bring them into the space and help them understand.
I think that might be one of the issues with the digital world as well, because if you just look at the digital information on the tube, and you never actually get to see the car or what you're trying to experience, it's actually something, it's different. So you actually need to get that collaboration, you need to get them to fall in love with the same vehicle so that they want to engineer it in the same way.
And the worst of situations, if you don't get people engaged, this whole engineering designer becomes a transactional operation. You know, you're almost posting to each other information and getting return. It can't work like that. It has to be a real-time collaboration. And that gets back to my previous comment. Design used to be an arrogant organization.
Throw it over the wall.
And that's, you've seen vehicles in the past that represent that design, orgasmic, we love this thing, and then you give it to the engineer who is sitting behind a wall, and then they have to interpret it. And then they hand it on to manufacturing, they interpret it, and this commodity that comes out the end has none of the emotion that was put in at the front. So if you don't do that, and you don't work in real time, and you don't collaborate with people, you don't learn to trust each other, so nothing happens.
One thing that we're still learning to do this, so there's this awful word in our industry called design freeze. Right, so you have a typical two and a half year program, and then this line in the sand, you cross this date, and the engineers say, pencils down, design freeze, you can't change anything anymore. Because they know that if you never stop designing, they can't start the tools. But there's invariably something that has to be adjusted, invariably a part doesn't fit, or a supplier doesn't have the capability, yada, yada, yada. So we've created a culture where they welcome us back in when they hit that impasse, that inevitable impasse. We go in there, and instead of them taking on our supplier blindly changing the part and eroding the design, we're involved, right? I mean, literally from cradle to grave, all the way to the plant launch, we're actually in the plant looking at how things are coming together. So we never stop being involved, and they love it, so they come to us all the time for, can you help us with this?
And funnily enough, designers actually enjoy being involved in the whole process. I mean, there's nothing better at the end than having something you envisage become real. I mean, that's the hair on the back of the neck. That's the emotion in the business.
So there's no point in saying, oh, you should have seen the clay model. It looked great, you know. And then the car comes out, it doesn't look anything like it. You know, I mean, it gives the designer that sense of achievement, but no one else, you know. So
We sometimes cry about some of the things that happen along the way, but then that gets to we talked about before, the not the compromise, but the balance between the criteria and the style, and if you get the balance right, you get a great product. If one side's in, ultimately wins, then you're gonna have a poorer outcome.
But it takes extra effort, right?
Yeah. It's a real job now.
It's a real job. Yeah.
And that's what we do.
Andy, we have a question in the second row, and this will have to be our last one, unfortunately.
It's just.
Oh God.
There have been a lot of, I'm sorry, my name's Dan Eastwood, retired engineer. There have been a lot of really great designers through the years. I know you guys are all familiar with them, but I'm just going to throw a few names out. Jean Bugatti, Gandini, Franco Scaglione. I happen to be favorites of Italians. But what I'd like to ask is for each of you to, wave a magic wand and give yourself permission to go back in history and be another designer, see the world through their eyes for 24 hours. See the world through their eyes and feel how their brain thinks. Pardon?
Can you have two?
Sure. But I'd like to know which one would you pick and why?
That's a great question.
Yeah,
that's an awesome question.
I got two, that's why. Andaloni and Mitchell. Mitchell, I know there's lots and lots of stories, but the reality is the stuff that was created back then was brilliant, and a lot of it sits outside in these shows. And then Andaloni, because of the beautiful character, simpler surface, simple form, working at a time. My favorite period, if you like, is rather than today, is 30s, late 30s through into the early 70s. And Andaloni and Turing were doing some fabulous stuff.
The father as opposed to the son.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll give you two as well. And I know as soon as I walk out of here, I'll think, why don't I use that? Yeah, why don't I use that?
It's your favorite car. Which
is your favorite car, yeah. Alex Izagone, who did the Mini, I think would have been a brilliant person to watch, I think. I think it was that excellent sort of mixture of engineer and designer that did just some fantastic work, you know. And I think you've seen his sketches, and the car was a very practical car, but it's still probably one of the most efficient cars ever made, I think. And that's the type of guy I think would be great to have dinner with, I think, and sort of talk to and understand how he works. The other one would be a guy called Bertone, who did the Citroen DS, which I think would be an amazing thing to work on as well, because I keep telling people that family sedans are the most difficult car to make exciting, but the DS was, he was amazing how he made that four-door sedan look incredible, I think, and it was certainly, you know, out there without anything else to compare it with. So I think, and I think to do that in the day it was on 59 or something.
It was
quite a spaceship, yeah. As it was presented at the Paris Style, it was just an amazing vehicle.
In 1955, can you believe it?
Yeah.
And I'm glad you guys didn't take any of my. Can I have three? So obviously Virgil Exner, being Chrysler, the forward lift, some of the stuff he was doing back then, being the underdog of the big three, right? Very, very flamboyant designs that really set the tone of popular culture in a way, really pushed, you know, the envelope of optimism through design. Scaglione, Franco, who did my favorite car in the whole world, Tipo 33, Stradale. I mean, just a gorgeous car. But those cars, I hate to say it, are easy to do. The low slung, I mean, those proportions, mid-engine race cars. But when I think of designs that are relevant, that I still look at, and I own one of his, is Giorgetto Giugiaro, because he designed a lot of the Golf. He designed the Giulietta's and a lot of great cars that were everyday cars. It's one thing to make a flamboyant, low-volume car look good, but when you're trying to make masses of cars look great. And his designs, I felt, were very understated, and because of that, they still look good today. The Giulia, the GTV Gran Veloce is amazing, still to this day.
What do you have?
GTV Junior,
69. Very nice.
Well, we have to wind up here. I can't thank you enough for when we managed to get these gentlemen, we're amazed. And I've been thinking about this seminar for months as the design summit, the top of the mountain, how we managed to get these giants together is beyond me. I want to thank them for coming. I want to thank you for the full house, for the great questions. Have a wonderful weekend. And once again, thank you all.
Pleasure.
Michael, yep. Murray, Ralph.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you